Hello friends, in the previous lecture we have talked about that how a covalent bond is formed, and basically the whole chapter is basically meant for ionic bond as well as covalent bond especially. So now we are going to talk about the new theory, that is valence bond theory. And so what is valence bond theory? And it is very important for us to understand that, because this detail or this theory gives us various details about how a covalent bond has been formed. So let us talk about it. So before understanding the valence bond theory, we should understand the postulates of valence bond theory. But what is actually valence bond theory? Actually, valence bond theory gives us the detail of the direction of the orbitals which a particular valence shell consists of. And because obviously we know that a valence shell consists of various orbitals, might be s, p, d or f. So during the bond formation with other atoms, they are forming a kind of direction. So that's the reason that they'll make a particular angle, or they will have a particular geometry. So this all are the details that could be explained with the help of the valence bond theory. So let us understand the postulates of it, and let us understand it each of it one by one. So talking about the first one, that is, a covalent bond is formed only when the half-filled orbitals of the two atoms overlap each other. So this is the first point that we are going to talk about, and this is the most crucial one. So if you are talking about the noble gases, so the noble gases doesn't consist of an unpaired electrons. All the electrons that are present in its valence shell, it has been completely occupied. So basically it is already fulfilled, and there is no chance of formation of basically an unpaired electron. So that's the reason that noble gases doesn't form bond with any other compound. But talking about the sodium and chlorine, chlorine consists of basically one unpaired electron in its outermost shell. So let me explain you that also. So if I draw the structure of, or if I represent the structure of chlorine 70, so I could get, it is can be written as, that is 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p5. So since we are talking about orbitals and not the orbit, so that this is the outermost orbital, and that is p orbital or p subshell. So p subshell consists of 3 orbitals, and as it consists of 5 electrons, so therefore this is 1, 2, 3, that is, this is 4 and 5. So in this case, this pz orbital, it consists of one unpaired electron, and that's the reason that it is capable of forming the bond with that of Na, that is sodium 11. This is the atomic number 11, so therefore I could write it as 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s1. So talking about the last shell, and that is the third shell, it consists of 3s orbital, and this 3s orbital consists of only one electron. So this is unpaired electron, and even this is unpaired electron. So now they will have the capability for forming a bond. So this is what the first point is, and this is the detail that we are going to talk about in this theory. So this is the first one that we have got to know, that is, a covalent bond is formed only when the half-filled orbitals of the two atoms overlap each other. So this is the first thing that we have got to know. Talking about the next one. So the second point says that each overlapping atomic orbital should contain an unpaired electron with opposite spin. So that is what I am going to explain with the help of this example. So suppose this is NaCl, and both are forming, this is the ionic bond that we are talking about. But suppose if I am talking about like HCl, so HCl is the one which is basically having an 1s1. So it consists of one unpaired electron. So now H and Cl, they both can form bond with each other, and because we are talking about a covalent bond, so but during overlapping, the both the electrons should be of opposite spin, means one should be of plus s plus half spin, while the other one should be of minus half spin, and then only the bond will take place. So this is the second point that we have mentioned about it. And talking about the next one, that is, the overlapping atomic orbital must have nearly the same energy. So this is also the main point that we are going to talk about. But yeah, talking about that is HCl. So p orbital consists of basically a particular energy. In fact, every orbital consists of a particular energy. But only a molecule, or only a bond is been formed when a particular atom which has a particular valence orbital that combines with that of the other unpaired electron, and which is belonging to a particular orbital. So if the both have almost the same energy, then only the bond will happen. And this is what it is talking about, that is, the overlapping atomic orbital must have nearly the same energy. So that's the reason H can combine with Cl. But even though the polar nature has been observed, but while talking about the carbon and hydrogen, while talking about in methane, so carbon has an outermost of p orbital, while that of the hydrogen, it has outermost shell of s orbital, or outermost shell which consists of s orbital, and that s orbital combines with that of the p orbital of the that is carbon, and that. And that's the reason that it forms the bond between carbon and hydrogen. So this is the third point that I wanted to explain to you. So talking about the next point, that is the fourth point. The electron spin get neutralized and electron gets paired up. Obviously, that one will be of opposite spin. Both of them will be of opposite spin. Means one is of positive half value and the one will have a negative half value, suppose. So if they both will combine, obviously they will neutralize each other, and that is what it is talking about. That is, the electron spins get neutralized and the electrons get paired up, and then only the electron will get paired up. So this is what I want to explain to you. That is, suppose I am talking about hydrogen and talking about Cl. So whenever the hydrogen and this is the thing that I am talking about when the overlapping happens. So this is the orbital where we could see the bonding will take place. So suppose this is the one which is of hydrogen, which is of having plus s, or s is equals to having a plus half charge, plus half value. By talking about the chlorine, which will have basically negative half value. So if you combine these two, it will neutralize, and that is the reason that we could see that the overlapping also can take place, and you cannot see the orbital which is having the same spin. This is never observed. So that is what the point fourth, that is what I want to talk about. And let us move on to the next point. So now let us move on to the next point. That is, during overlapping of atomic orbitals, electron density increases between the two nucleus or two nuclei, and therefore the repulsion between the nuclei decreases. Obviously, we know that during the bond formation, obviously two atoms will combine with each other and so as to form a bond. But it is not only the electrons that they will combine with each other, or they will share the electrons. It is not the atom that will share the electrons, but during the formation of a bond, obviously, or during during the interaction, obviously the nucleus of one atom can be interacted with the nucleus of the other atom. So in this case, nucleus is the one which has a positive charge, while the other nucleus is also which consists of positive charge. So while interacting it, they will feel a repulsion force. So as to compensate that, because whenever a bond forms, we know that only the valence electrons are the one that are being able to form a bond. And that is the reason, or the unpaired electrons, they are able to form a bond, and that is the reason during the bond formation, even the difference or the repulsion between the nucleus and the nucleus of the two atoms, they will get reduced, and that is how the attraction start takes place, while the nucleus will have an attraction towards the electron of the other atom, while the electron will have the attraction towards the other nucleus. So therefore, the attractive force of, or we could say more attractive force, we could observe, and we could say that the repulsion will be reduced. And this is how the bond formation takes place. And talking about the next one, that is, yes, during this actually bond formation, energy will be released. Obviously, when two atoms, they will collide with each other, or they will combine with each other, energy will be released. And this indicates that the more the energy will be released, then the bond formation will be more, and the stronger the bond will be. So it depends on the thing. That is what we are going to talk about in the next topics or next points also. So let us talk about the sixth point. So the sixth point says that a bond is formed at equilibrium distance when the system has minimum potential energy and maximum stability. So this is what I want to explain. So a bond has been formed at equilibrium distance. Suppose if the two atoms are of having the same kind of electronegativity, or we could call it as they have the atomic orbital, or combining atomic orbitals, they have suppose the same energy, then we could see that there will be having a minimum potential energy and maximum stability. They will acquire maximum stability, and that's the reason, and that is the only reason that they are forming the bond, and that makes the bond to be more stronger and more interactive to hold the two atoms. And this is what the sixth point is. And let us talk about the next one. That is the seventh point, and it says that the strength of the covalent bond depends upon the extent of overlap of orbital between the two atoms. Obviously, the covalent bond will be more stronger. It will depend on the extent in which the two orbitals means of two different atoms, they combine with each other. So the more the overlapping, then we could say the more the stronger the bond would be, and that is the reason that they will form a stronger bond, and the interaction between the two atoms will be more, and so as to break it, it will require more energy. And it will depend on how they are oriented or how they are overlapping. Even the overlapping are of the two types, that is lateral overlapping and that is head-on collision, we could say. So even that depends on that thing. So these are the things that we are going to talk about in the next lecture. And let's talk about the next point, that is the 8th point says that the number of covalent bond formed by an atom of an element is equals to the number of unpaired electrons present in the valence atom. Obviously, for example, if I'm talking about the carbon has a valence electron of 4, and that's the reason it forms 4 bond. But it is not necessary, because talking about the nitrogen also has 5 electrons in its outermost shell, but in that case, not all of the 5, only 3 of the one which are forming the bond, and that is the reason that we are talking about covalent bond. So that is the thing, and let us move on with the next one. So now let us move on to the next point, and the next point says that each atomic orbital except s orbital has a particular direction in space. So that is what I am talking about. So that is talking about the s orbital has a particular shape, and that is spherical shape. And talking about the p orbitals have basically a number shape, and they are basically divided into px orbital, py orbital and pz orbital. And talking about d and f also, they have a particular shape, or they have particular direction in which they have been involved. So talking about the s orbital, they don't have any kind of direction, and that's the reason that this VBT or valence bond theory is basically related to the directions that are being shown by the orbitals, that is p, d and f. And talking about the orbital, every orbital has its own axis of direction, that we could say. So this is the 9th point that we are going to talk about. And talking about the application of this, we are going to make an application that how it has been applied in actually the bond formation. So this is what we are going to talk about. So move on to the next one, that is the 10th point, and it says that the geometry of a molecule is decided by the direction orientation of the overlapping of orbitals. So obviously, that is the geometry of a molecule, whether it would be a planar structure, or whether it would be, you could say, triangular planar, tetrahedral. So this all kind of structure, actually this will depend on the direction of the orbitals. So if we are talking about the overlapping orbitals, that is talking about HCl. So H is the one which has S orbital, and chlorine which has P orbital. So S has no direction on it. So it is a non-directional orbital. So that is the reason that it can combine with any of the P orbital in any direction, and the bond will occur. But talking about the methane will obviously, it will have a particular direction. It will combine with that of a direction with that of the hydrogen. But talking about that of the ethene, so in that case the direction also matters, and that's the reason that a carbon-carbon double bond has been occurring. So that also plays a very vital role, and to show the geometry of the molecule. So there are a few topics that we are going to talk about and the application of it. So these were the few examples that I was talking about. So thank you friends for watching this video. I hope you have understood this video very clearly, and you have got to know that what is actually valence bond theory. And I hope you will share this video with the friends, and don't forget to subscribe to Ekeeda channel. Thank you so much.